introduce our speaker of the hour, because it is a delight beyond measure to do so. I'll leave my little commentary for the end. The good Reverend Maressa Pendermon is an ordained reverend in the Unity Fellowship Church movement, currently serving as senior pastor of Unity Fellowship Church of Christ in Greater Atlanta. She also works as a hospice chaplain, providing spiritual care for individuals living with a terminal diagnosis and their families. In addition, Reverend Pendermon is a community strategist as well as a trained facilitator. She is passionate about social justice issues and, wait for it, peace building, huh? That's what peace building. Somebody received that. She does her work in community with traditionally marginalized and low wealth individuals and communities from a human rights perspective and through a womanist theological lens. A native of Boston, Massachusetts, where she was raised in public housing, Maressa has been involved in advocacy, organizing, and coalition building since the early 1980s. She holds, wait for it, a Bachelor of Science in Criminal Justice from Albany State University, a Juris Doctor from the University of Maryland College of Law, and a Master's of Divinity from Candler School of Theology at Emory University. She also holds facilitation, organizational, and organizational development certificates from the Interaction Institute for Social Change in Cambridge, Massachusetts. She is a woman on fire, a fire, from fire. I think that would wrap it up. So immediately after an anointed creative arts dance performance, the next voice you will hear will be that of the senior pastor of Unity Fellowship Church of Christ Church in Greater Atlanta, the woman of God who is the Right Reverend Maressa Pendermon. Dance and then get ready to, huh?
Feels so good to make it this far. And I didn't think I could take it so long. There were days I wanted to quit. I said, surely this is it. But I held on. And I've watched as so-called friends turned and walked away. And it hurt so much I didn't have words to say. But even when my day turns to night and nothing seems just right, Lord, I thank you for my life. For my life. Lord, I thank you for every victory in you I've seen. And all the
even me, Lord, yes. yes, yes, and yes. Are y'all able to hear me well? Great. I want to honor God for this opportunity and to the committee who invited me, Reverend Cheryl, and your committee. Thank you for thinking of me in this way. I want to honor your pastor, who is and has always been fabulous. I love and adore him. I enjoy our time, even though it's brief, that we get to work together in national ways. We were on a project at one time where we were working together more. I hope we can do it again someday. To your assistant pastor, Reverend Jerry Lee Mitchell, I want to honor her during this Women's History Month and always for her faithfulness. She's been running for Jesus for a long time. She was here when I got here and always gracious and always loving. And I'm so glad to serve alongside of her as well. And to all of you, the family of God, I am delighted to worship with you this morning. I don't know why I have not worshiped with you before now, other than that our service starts at 12:30 and I'm a little lazy now. So I'm gonna have to get up because that music, that selection, that dance, that was fire. And it blessed my soul. So thank you so much. Let's get to it. This morning, I am going to try to honor your theme. It's personal. I'm going to preach from the subject, the person in the personal. The person in the personal. I want to lift up the psalm that you've chosen. As I was taught when I kept reading, I want to extend it a little bit further from verses 1 through 6 and lift up verse 6 as a focus text. And I also want to add Psalm 51. I'm not going to read either one of them in the interest of time, but I invite you to read them both. They are rich and meaty and juicy in their own right. And the focus text from the 51st Psalm is going to be verse 10. So Psalm 51, verse 10, and Psalm 18, verse 6. Psalm 18, verse 6 says, "In my distress, I called upon the Lord. To my God, I cried for help. From his temple, he heard my voice, and my cry to him reached his ears." Psalm 51 and 10 says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me," or renew in me a right spirit. Amen. And so I want to lift these up because we're talking about the person in the personal. The Psalter, or the Book of Psalms, is a collection of hymns, poems, and prayers that were written by individuals, but were always read or performed in public worship spaces. The Psalter is a collection of 5 different books, and we find this psalm, Psalm 18, in the first part of the book of Psalms. And I want you to know that if I couldn't have any other Bible, I would want the book of Psalms, because as your theme reminds us, in the book of Psalms, it's personal. It is deeply personal. It is a book where individuals writing about their personal experiences, where they are talking to their personal God. If you notice, it says, I called upon the Lord, and to my God I cried for help. It said, create in me a clean heart, O God. It's personal. It is first person personal, and their God is personal to them. In all of the 150 Psalms that we have, it is personal just like that. And so if you had to take away my Bible, I would like for you to leave me the book of Psalms, because it is a personal God that we're talking to and about in Psalms. And in the context of community, the people who are writing the Psalms, David only wrote 70 of them, maybe even just about 66. Whoever is writing the Psalm, it is personal work that they're doing in the context of community. Just because it's personal don't mean it has to be private. Some things need to be opened up in the context of community. And that's what we have here in the Psalms. I'm going to hurry because I'm fired up from y'all's music. So I'm going to hurry, but I'm going to slow down so I can teach this thing the way that God has given it to me. So today, just for a few moments, I want to lift up these two Psalms because I'm talking about the person and the personal. And both of these Psalms were penned by King David. David is the person in the personal here. When he writes Psalm 18, he is in a spirit of praise, and he should be in a spirit of praise because he is just coming out of a time in his life, a period on his journey where haters was on his back. There were folk trying to kill him, not because of anything he had necessarily done in that moment, but they were trying to kill him because of who God had called him to be. I want you to know that God will call you into places and everybody won't be happy for your elevation. Everybody won't think that you deserve to be where God is calling you to. And so you might have some folk that are seeking to assassinate you, even though you haven't done anything. It don't have to be with an assassin's bullet. Sometimes it's just with the tongue. Sometimes it's just with the way that they look at you. Sometimes it's just with the way that they don't show up when it's your turn. Sometimes it's just in the way that they act and behave in your presence and outside of your presence. And David had been experiencing this. We don't know exactly how long they had been chasing him, but they had been chasing him for quite some time. And so on the very day that God delivers David from David's enemies, he writes this song. It's a psalm of praise. He's talking to a God that in his distress has heard his cry. That's the personal part. That's his testimony. In my distress, when I was jacked up, David's testimony is that I ain't always been king. I ain't always been on top of the world. And there was a time when I had some distresses in my life. But even while those things was going on, I was in relationship with a God, a personal relationship with a God who was able to deliver me. He didn't deliver me every time I called on him. I was wondering while I was still running and ducking and dodging and hiding in caves, because I didn't quite understand that my time is not necessarily God's time. But in God's own time, God delivered me. He says, I called upon the Lord. And then he says, I want to make it plain to you. He says, to my God, I cried for help. This thing is personal. I'm in relationship with this dude. And from his temple, he heard my cry. And my cry reached his ears. And then God not only heard my cry, but God acted on my behalf. That's David in Psalms 18, praising God for his mighty words, praising God for his deliverance. And then we move over to the 51st Psalm. And this is not a psalm of praise. This is what is called a penitent psalm. In other words, it is a psalm where David is in confession mode. He's not praising God. He is confessing to God. He's lived a little bit. He's been king for a little while. He's done some stuff. And he realizes that in all his ways, he ought to acknowledge God. Some of us only want to be in praise mode. Some of us are trying to hurry up and get to Easter Sunday. But some stuff happens before the resurrection. We have to own our stuff before we can get to the part where I got up from it. We have to own the place where we fell down first. You got to fall down first before you can get back up again. And so David is a little bit older now than he was in Psalm 18. And he is reflecting. I wonder, do you ever take time to just reflect on your stuff? He is reflecting on how he got to be where he is. And he's sort of nearing the end of his journey, and he's taking stock. And he begins the psalm by saying, have mercy on me, oh God. Every now and then you gotta do like the saints of old and cry out, have mercy on me, oh God. According to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. In other words, you are a God that is love, not a God that shows love. The very essence of what you are is love. Everything about you is loving. And sometimes I have taken advantage of that, and I have stepped outside of love. I have walked outside of love, and I have transgressed. I have moved away from that essence in me that is supposed to be love. And so he says, God, created me a clean heart. Out of the abundance of the heart we speak, out of the abundance of the heart we act. And so when our behavior is not loving, it's a heart condition. Something is wrong with our heart. And so he says, create in me, oh God, a clean heart, and renew in me a right spirit. In other words, I've been out of line. I've messed up. I've done some things. It's personal. I don't want to admit everything that I've done. We've had our little talks in private. But right now, today, I'm asking you to just create in me a clean heart and renew in me a right spirit. The person in the personal is David, and his testimony is both. And I want to praise you, God, and I need your forgiveness, God. But I could not rightly call myself a womanist if I missed this opportunity during this Women's History Month to lift up another person in the personal. Her voice we don't hear in either one of these psalms, because these ain't her psalms. But I believe she wrote some psalms, and her name is Bathsheba. And we would not have Psalm 51 if it had not been for Bathsheba. Because in Psalm 51, the thing that David is repenting from is the fact that he saw Bathsheba doing what the law required her to do. She had been on her menstrual cycle. And in that day, if when you had your menstrual cycle, you were unclean and you had to take a ritual bath after your menstrual cycle in order to be welcomed back into the fold, in order to be lifted up. Sisters, if we don't talk about it, no, we might not find the story here, but sometimes our story is just a footnote in the story of one of the brothers in the text, but it's our job people who are in the image of the feminine divine, whether your body is exterior, is male or female, we are all connected to the feminine divine. And so I want to talk for just a few minutes about the person Bathsheba. Bathsheba was minding her own business, bathing in her bathtub, and King David looked over and saw her and said, she fine. I want her. And so he calls for his servants to go and get her. And you didn't say no to the king. If the king summoned you, you came. And so perhaps Bathsheba was thinking on her way to the king's house. He must have news about my husband who is fighting on the front lines in a war that is on his behalf. Or maybe he got something to tell me about my father, who is one of his generals. Not sure what the king wants, but I'm going to see the king because he called for me. And when she gets there, David, who is the apple of God's eye, the sweet psalmist of Israel, I don't care who you are and how good you are, you ain't been good all the time. You got some stuff, some personal stuff that you might not want everybody to know. The same King David raped Bathsheba while she was in the king's house, and she became pregnant unbeknownst to him, and she went back to her house after he was through with her. He sent her home, and then a few weeks later, the word comes to David that Bathsheba is pregnant, and they don't know how they're going to explain this to her husband, Uriah, who ain't been home. He's been on the front lines of war. He's been in the military doing what military folks do. And so how in the world are they going to explain that Bathsheba is now pregnant? And so David, who is still acting outside of love, decides that he's going to kill Uriah, Bathsheba's husband, and then he's going to marry Bathsheba so that he can claim this baby, quote, legitimately. And so he does all of that. And he impregnates Bathsheba, and he then tries to right the wrong by marrying her, but he has to do more wrong in order to marry her because she's already Uriah's husband. So he has to kill Uriah to get to her. When you step outside of love, my grandmother said it like this: if you tell one lie, you're gonna have to tell another lie to cover up for that lie. When you step outside of love, when you start doing things that don't amount to what God has called you to do and who God has called you to be, then you get yourself caught up in a web of stuff, and it's a domino effect, and so all of that happened. And I just imagine that there were some nights that Bathsheba wrote some songs of her own. I can imagine that she cried out to her God. I can imagine that Bathsheba somewhere hidden in the tablets that we haven't yet uncovered, there are some songs of lament from Bathsheba. I can imagine that she was saying, God, where you at? I've done what you've asked me to do. I've been faithful. I've been a good wife. I've been obedient. And why is all of this happening to me? But I also can imagine that Bathsheba, who became the mother of Solomon, had some other songs that she wrote. I believe that she had some praise songs, because even in our darkest hour, what God is reminding us constantly that trouble will come. I didn't promise you that trouble wasn't coming, but trouble don't last always. And so after a while and by, Bathsheba was redeemed in her own heart and in her own spirit. And I can imagine that she said, too, in my distress, because it's personal, y'all. There's a person in the personal. Bathsheba in her personal, I can imagine that she, too, said, in my distress, when I was being used and abused and mistreated, I called upon my God, and my God heard me too. He didn't just hear the king. God don't just hear those that are in power. God is the God of everybody. I can imagine that Bathsheba would say, God heard me too. And he redeemed me from a place where when I was put to shame, when I was put in a position where I could have been stoned to death, I should have been killed because I was pregnant outside of my marital relationship. But instead, God created a space for me to be redeemed in marriage in the context of my community. Then God gave me 4 children who I gave back to God. And one of my babies became king of Israel. We call him Solomon. And one of my babies wrote in Proverbs about me as a virtuous woman. I can imagine that Bathsheba would tell us, but there were some times where I wanted to kill the king. There were some times where my anger got the best of me. There were some times when I had to repent too, and I had to say, Lord, have mercy on me. I don't know how, I don't know when, I don't even know what you're doing, but I believe that you're doing it. I believe that she had to say, Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew in me a right spirit. Your situation is not always going to change. I don't want to be the bearer of bad news, but sometimes the mess that you find yourself in, sometimes due to no fault of your own, is going to stay a mess. But what I can promise you, that even in the midst of the mess, it's personal. And God will change the person in the personal. God might not change the situation, but God will change you in the midst of the situation. And I believe that that is what happened with Bathsheba. She became David's favorite wife. He began treating her like she was nothing, and he ultimately had to treat her like the queen that God had ordained her to be. She became the queen of Israel, Rael, and she wore her crown with pride and dignity. A woman who should have been stoned sat on the throne with pride and dignity. Because there is always a personal in the person. It is always a person in the personal. And the it of the it's personal depends on who you're talking to. Sometimes your it will be a praise. And sometimes your it will be a repentance. Sometimes your it will be a dance. And sometimes your it will be a cry. It's personal. It's between you and God. You and God are in this dance. I couldn't call myself someone who reads the Bible through a womanist lens, if I didn't stop by to tell you that even though the person that is lifted up is David, that there were other persons, and that your personal impacts other people's personal. It might be personal to you, but you are having an impact on your sisters and your brother. And so, even though it is personal, and indeed it is, God is requiring us to not keep everything personal in private. Give God a hand.